हेलो चिल्ड्रन, वी आर बैक अगेन विद योर क्लास 12th पॉलिटिकल साइंस एंड यू मस्ट बी अवेयर आई एम फरा दीवाहा फ्रॉम आदरणीय संध्या पब्लिक स्कूल. वी विल बी कंटिन्यूइंग विद योर लेक्चर बिकॉज वी वांट दैट यू शुड कीप ऑन स्टडिंग एंड डू नॉट मिस आउट विद योर स्टडीज. कीप स्टडिंग एंड स्टे एट होम टू स्टे सेफ. सो एज in the previous lectures we have already taken a couple of chapters from both the books, and as I told you earlier also, I am reiterating the same that there will be a little change in the syllabus this year, but that we will come to know. Of course you must have come to know about from the sites as well as in the lectures also. So we are merging the chapters and we are renaming the chapters as per the new syllabus. But if you have the old books, don't be panicky because you can keep on studying with your old books. The new topics I'm taking up here in the class, as well as you will be getting the detailed instructions about it later on also. So today we will be beginning the third chapter of Politics in India Since Independence. This chapter is India's Foreign Policy. Previously it was named as India's External Relations, but this year we will be naming it as India's Foreign Policy. That is one of more the same thing. Moreover, a few more relationships with other countries will be included. So today we are beginning with the third chapter, that is India's Foreign Policy. As you all know that when India achieved freedom, there were a lot of problems that India was facing, and not only India, the entire countries of the world, they were facing a lot of problem. Among them, the first problem was the world had already witnessed a devastating war, that is the war of 1945. The Second World War has ended that time and was grappling with issues of reconstruction. So much of destruction had been caused by the World War that many countries of the world, they were virtually undergoing the process of reconstruction. Moreover, there was an attempt to establish an international body, which was, as you all know, that the United Nations. The basic aim of setting up the United Nations was to avoid the chances of any further war. One very important thing during this period was that many new countries were emerging as a result of the collapse of colonialism. So colonialism was actually coming to an end, and many countries were achieving freedom. So most of these newly independent countries, they were facing two problems. One was the problem of welfare, and the other was the problem of democracy. Now this was a general problem that were faced by the countries of the world during that period. If you talk about specifically about India, then India specifically was facing a lot of problems along with this. The first one, that British government had left behind a legacy of many international disputes. There were many disputes which have already been left behind by the Britishers for India to solve. Moreover, we have already discussed this in the first chapter. The partition had created its own pressure. Lots of unrest was caused because of the partition. Loss of life and property was there, and India was also undergoing a lot of pressure as an after effect of this partition. Then the task of poverty alleviation. India was left in a condition of severe poverty. So poverty alleviation was also one of the tasks which needed fulfillment. So if you talk about what was India's aim while framing the foreign policy, India's aim was first to respect the sovereignty of all other nations. India wanted to respect all the nations that have got achieved independence, and India also wanted to achieve security through the maintenance of peace and development in their own neighborhood. As you all know, that Indian subcontinent India is surrounded by a lot of countries. So India basically wanted good relationship with all its neighbors so that no further expense should be there on violence or on maintaining peace, and most of the money could be used for the economic development of a newly formed country, that was India. Before we come to the foreign policy, one more thing we have already discussed in the chapters in contemporary world politics, that this was the time when the world was divided into two main camps. The first camp led by US, led the NATO, which was under the influence of US and its Western allies, and the second group, that was the Soviet-led Warsaw Pact. This was under the influence of the Soviet Union. So there was a lot of contest that whether India will join the capitalist group or will India join the socialist group. So India decided to stay away. We have already discussed. India decided to stay away from both these groups and follow the policy of non-alignment. A lot many leaders of the country itself, some of them they said that this was not the correct motive for a weak country like India, a newly formed country like India. They felt that India should either join one US or it should some supported US led group, and the other supported the socialist group which was led by Soviet Union. So, but Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru took the stand, and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was the first Prime Minister of the country. He was also the foreign minister. So he decided, and he was, as you know, the co-founder, one of the main founders of the non-aligned movement. So he decided to stay away from both these camps, and he had a profound influence in the formulation and implementation of India's foreign policy from 1946 to 1964, because this was the period immediately after independence. The period was dominated by the Congress Party, and of course Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru led the Congress Party, so his impact was a lot on the India's foreign policy. So Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had three main objectives as far as the India's foreign policy is concerned. First was to preserve the hard-earned sovereignty. Of course, India had achieved sovereignty after a long reign of the Britishers and other foreigners. Moreover, the second objective was to protect the territorial integrity. Already the partition had taken place, so India wanted that no further such problems should occur and the territories should remain integrated. And the third was to promote a rapid economic development. And the purpose was the same, to alleviate the country from a severe poverty crisis. So the Indian foreign policy pursued the dream of a peaceful world by advocating the policy of non-alignment, by reducing the Cold War tensions which were taking place between the Soviet Union and the United States, by contributing human resources to the UN peacekeeping operations. Then also, and throughout the time period, whenever the United Nations has gone for any peacekeeping operation, India has always supported it. So India took independent stand on various international issues. This was the time when Pakistan decided to join the American bloc. That was the camp which was led by United States. And this caused a considerable amount of unease between the India and the United States during the 1950s. And moreover, the United States were also unhappy with India's growing relationship, yet India's growing friendship and partnership with the Soviet Union. So a lot of unease was there between India and US in the 1950s. This was a just an introduction of what was the main objectives of the foreign policy and what was the basic concept of India's foreign policy. Now let's talk about the Afro-Asian unity. As far as Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was concerned, he envisaged a major role of India in the Asian affairs, and he looked forward to support the newly independent states of Asia and Africa, and he wanted to establish ties and contacts and friendship between these newly independent countries of Asia and Africa and India. So throughout the 1940s and the 1950s, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had been an ardent advocate of Asian unity. This led to the existence of, to the formation of the Asian Relations Conference in March 1947, which was convened by India under the leadership of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. He also made strong efforts for the freedom of Indonesia from the Dutch colonial regime. And he also led a conference there supporting the freedom of Indonesia. He was a staunch supporter of decolonization process, and he opposed the racism. You already know about the apartheid, the concept of apartheid. So he was a staunch supporter of decolonization. He wanted that all the countries of the world should be free and there should be no racial discrimination. These all contribution and this all progress led to the formation of the Afro-Asian Conference, which was held in 1955 in Bendon. This conference was also famously known as Bendon Conference. So this conference, what they did, it marked the peak, the zenith of India's relationship with the newly independent Asian and African nation. And this Bendon Conference was the place which led to the establishment of NAM, that is the Non-Aligned Movement, whose first summit was later on took place in Belgrade in 1961. So that's why the formation of NAM is directly associated with the Bendon Conference. So this was the relationship between newly formed African nations and Asian nations. Now comes a very important relationship of India, and that was with China. As you see, I have named it as peace and conflict with China, because it is not the case that India has always been an enemy. There was always animosity between India and China. The relationship between India and China had begun on a very friendly note, and the friendship was such that the Chinese borders were not guarded by army, they were guarded by the paramilitary force. Though some leaders who were far-sighted, like Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, he was not very happy with India's such friendly faith or trust in China's friendship. Why? Because he always foresighted that some or the other aggressive behavior was there on part of China, and this aggressive behavior can later on take the form of war. But Pandit Nehru was not in such a boat, so he was very happy with the relationship India had with China, and he always considered it to be a very strong relationship, and this only led to the joint enunciation of the Panchsheet, the five policies of peace. The Panchsheet was signed between the Indian Prime Minister Pandit Nehru and the Chinese Premier Hao Enlai on 29 April 1954, and this was a step in the direction of stronger relationship between the two countries. But side by side, two different things were happening in which caused a strain in the relationship between India and China. The first was the case of Tibet. Tibet has always been a bone of contention between India and China. China annexed what China did. China annexed Tibet in 1950 and thus removed a historical buffer between the two countries. Initially, India overlooked all this. He did not pay heed to all this. But what happened gradually, the Tibetan culture and the Tibetan people were pressurized, were dominated by the Chinese, and eventually what happened, the spiritual leader of Tibet, the Dalai Lama, he obtained political asylum in India in 1959, and this was a very important reason that strained the relationship between India and China. Secondly, there was a boundary dispute that surfaced between India and China, and this dispute was basically because of two Indian areas. In fact, two areas which were there in the Indian territory. The first was the Aksai Chit area, that is in the Ladakh region of Jammu and Kashmir, and much of Arunachal Pradesh, which was called as NEFA, that is Northeast Frontier Agency. So what China did? China occupied Aksai Chit area between 1957 and 1959. And this was the period when the entire world was actually concerned about the Cuban Missile Crisis, where both the superpowers were engaged. So China took benefit of this situation, and what China did? China invaded the disputed regions in October 1962. These invasions further led on to various other invasions. We will be discussing the same, the Chinese invasion and the reasons for the strained relationship between China and India, and later on the improvements in the forthcoming lecture. Till then, stay safe.